Good morning, everybody. We're glad to see you here at Fair Park. We welcome all of you to church today. Glad you're here, and we welcome those online today, and pray that together we can worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Going to ask Brother Al to play an opening for us, and thank you again for being here with us today. Brenda will lead us in our praise worship this morning.
Please stand, everybody. I want to welcome you to church this morning. Hopefully I can stay standing. I've got a knee problem. Church, and let's make it a little bit warmer outside. It's a little cool this morning. It'll probably warm up this afternoon, but Well, let's raise our voices to the Lord. Al?
It's really good to see you here today, and we're glad you're in God's house. Doug and Cheryl are gone for just a few days, and we'll be back to our number, so pray for their safety of travel. And many prayer needs we want to share in just a few minutes, but first we want to go to the Lord in prayer, ask His blessings on this hour, this service that we have together, and pray that today, in a very special way, He meets with us as we desire to meet with Him. Heavenly Father, we come before you with praise and thanksgiving. We honor the name of Jesus before men and women. And Lord, we pray that today our hearts are desirous of learning of Thee, of drawing into Your presence, Lord, just a little closer. So today, might our hearts be on fire for You. Might our thoughts be full of Jesus. And might we just have a smile on our face as we exemplify the love of Jesus and the grace of God in our lives. Lord, thank You for allowing us to have another Sunday, another day to honor the name of Christ before men. And so, Lord, today, bless us, lead us, and guide us. And we ask this in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And just before you sit down, wave, say hello. You that are at home, shake your coffee cup. That'll work. We are so glad that you are here with us today. All right, you may be seated. We're going to have our scripture reading at this time.
Good morning. Our scripture lesson this morning is from Malachi, and it's chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way for me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will come bring offerings in righteousness. And the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in the days gone by, as in former years. So I will come near to you for judgment. I will be quick to testify against the sorcerers, adulterers, and perjurers, against those who defraud laborers of their wages, who oppose the widows and the fatherless, who deprive aliens of justice. But do not fear me, says the Lord Almighty. I, the Lord, do not change. So you, descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. This ends the morning scripture. Thank you.
Thank you, Norma. Appreciate that so very much. And we want to indeed remember quite a few special prayer needs. Just before we begin with that, let me wish Sharon a happy birthday. I think today is her birthday. Is that right? You don't have the big sombrero on. Ray said he was going to bring that for you, but I don't see it. Anyway, happy birthday. And then Ada Gruber will be 95 tomorrow. So she still is fighting on for her Lord. So you continue to pray for her, of course, home and certainly in need of our prayers. And we encourage you to remember her in a very special way. It's good to see some folks back in God's house today. Good to see Bob Johnston. We praise the Lord that he is up and almost ready to run a marathon, right? Not quite, but almost. So anyway, continue to pray for him. Good to see Gwen too. And we're just glad Bob is doing better after a couple of stints. And so we're praising the Lord for that. Good to see David and Janice Balgans in the Lord's house. Remember David, he's going to be having shoulder surgery in 1 week. Don't know yet. Okay, upcoming. But anyway, he wants to be able to throw his hand up and say praise the Lord and can't do it right now. So you pray for him for that shoulder surgery that he needs very, very much. Then also James Hartle very much needs our prayers today. He is in Riverside Hospital and a lot of health issues. Kidney dialysis has not done what needs to be done for him, so just very much in need of prayers. And so we ask you to remember James Hartle. That's of course, Hazel's nephew, and anyway, very much in need of prayer. Also continue to pray for Tata Postel. A lot of pain. I talked to her yesterday. A lot of pain still from her surgery, and just, I'm sure, from all the metal they took out of her legs. So anyway, continue to pray for her. Dolly French is home under hospice care. Visited with her this week. Also saw Becky Varner, that's her neighbor right across the way. Both very much in need of prayers, so please remember them in your prayers if you would today. Seems like Judy Griffith was a name that we were asked to pray for. That's on our prayer list at the bottom of the list. Remember Judy in your prayers if you would. And let me see, seems like I'm forgetting one or two. Trisha, thank you. Okay. Remember Trish, if you would, in a special way, Blankenship. She needs our prayers very much. And it's so good to see Sandy in church today. Sandy Crevison, we're thankful to see you, Sandy. Glad you're back in God's house. And pray for her. Still, I know, a devastating loss for her with the homegoing of Charlie. So you pray that God would bless her and support her with your love today, and just let her know that you're glad she's back in God's house. Kay, it's good to see you in church too. We're glad you're here with us today. Welcome you. And just every one of you, we're glad you're here. And I really, really mean that. A good looking crowd today. Ray, I see that hand. Yes, thank you. That was the one that I, thank you. Ron and Patty Sanderson, continue to pray for them. Ron had a kidney stone, had to go in the hospital last week, had to have it surgically removed. I took him home from the hospital a couple days ago, and he is home. Debbie and I took him over supper last night, and anyway, still pretty weak from that process, and just hurting some still. Patty still continues very much in kidney failure stage, so stage four, as I understand. So you pray for her that God would bless her in a very special way. Brother David? Yes. Okay. Remember Sammy Justice, if you would, in your prayers, please. And Debbie? Yes. Thank you. Okay. Ron Gates, knew him as a little guy. Anyway, he developed esophageal cancer about 4 weeks ago and took him very quickly. He passed away just a couple of days ago. So a friend of Debbie and mine, so if you would remember the Gates family in your prayers, please. And who, you mentioned someone?
Jim.
Yeah, thank you. Jim Shiflett has been back in the hospital. And they've determined he has gout, which is, they hadn't figured that out for a while. So anyway, hopefully medications will get him treated and strengthened back. Continue to pray for Gary fighting an infection. And so they both are in need of our prayers as well. Yes, Brother Dave.
I want to remember the show. We had to cancel my flower order in the funeral.
Okay, it's good. I'm glad Jeff is back and doesn't need those flowers. Amen. So anyway, he's doing much better, and praise the Lord for that. It's good to see all the Williams here today. Yes, Ruth Ellen. Yes, thank you. The Burns family. Rodney Burns passed away, and so please pray for that family as well. Indeed. Anybody else? Yes. Okay, remember Michaela in your prayers, if you would. Anyone else? All right, we are going to sing our prayer chorus, "Surely the Presence of the Lord is in This Place." We will sing it through twice, and second time around, please raise your hand if you have an unspoken request. Certainly those at home, we encourage you to do the same as well as we sing. presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. As we sing it again. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Just before I go to the Lord in prayer, I wanted to say I spoke with Don Griffin here this week, and anyway, a good report from the doctor, and we praise the Lord for that good update. So anyway, good news with him, and we want to share the good news as well as the prayer needs. So we're thankful today. Let's go to the Lord and ask His blessing in a special way. Heavenly Father, we come before You today knowing we need You more today than ever before. Lord, we pray for all those who are ill, for those who are unable to be with us because of illness. Lord, for this COVID virus that still is so active and still bothers quite a few, we pray that You would bless, Lord, and watch over them, and Lord, heal the ones that need Your healing hand. We pray, Lord, for those who have went home to be with the Lord, and we think of those families who just need a special touch of grace this day in their lives and in their hearts. Lord, we pray that You bless each one. Bless those who are in hospitals today. Bless those, Lord, who need Your healing hand in a very special way upon them this very moment. And Lord, we pray for the many hands that we saw uplifted, and hands we know uplifted there in their homes, in homes today. And we ask, Lord, that You would watch over each one. And Lord, Thy will be done, we pray. Lord, we are thankful for this hour that You give us, this time to worship the name of Jesus above all other names. And so, Lord, we pray today we might do that, and that we might honor the name of Christ and magnify His name. Lord, forgive us of our failures, that we might stand before You as soldiers of the cross. And let us, Lord, faithfully continue on until that day You call us to be with You. Lord, thank You for Your goodness. Thank You for Your presence today. And Lord, for all of these things, we pray and we ask in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Want to remind you of just a couple of things. Our men's fellowship breakfast, 9 a.m., that's on the 29th. And then September 3rd, 4th, and 5th is men's yard sale. So that's coming up pretty quick. If you have items you'd like to donate, if you would see either Lonnie or Ray or, well, just any of the men, I think will get you in contact with someone to help you with that. And anyway, hoping and praying that that'll be a great success. The last one was very successful. And in regards to that, let me remind you, if you did any business with Rural King, there was a couple of receipts brought in this morning. If you would get those turned in right away, those count. We have a 10% allowance that they're giving. Rural King is giving churches, and we're thankful for that. So as we turn them in, that will be going to the ladies group. So if you've done any business, be sure and get those turned in today, or let me know that you're going to be turning them in very quickly if you could. I would appreciate that. Also, thank you again for all your faithfulness in giving. We're thankful that God continues to meet our financial needs here at Fair Park, and We thank you for your individual responsibility that you accept and do in your giving. For those online who listen and watch, and we've had additional people who have sent in offerings, and we praise the Lord for your wanting to be a help to us here at Fair Park. So God is good, and we're thankful for that. We praise his name and give him honor and glory. And we remind you there's an offering plate as you go out the door. So don't forget that. I want to remind you of that. Brother Lonnie?
Yes, we're going to try to get a little work on the shelter house tomorrow.
Okay.
All
right. So if you didn't hear that, tomorrow at 9 a.m., if you'd like to help getting things ready for the men's yard sale, anyway, 9 a.m. tomorrow at the fellowship, or at the shelter house, rather, and we'll get things ready. By the way, we have formed a committee to start looking at replacing our ramp that goes up to the fellowship hall. I know we're not able right now to use the fellowship hall, but we have received one bid, and we'll be looking at a couple more. But anyway, we'll let you know more about that when we get a little bit farther. So, but anyway, just wanted you to be aware that that we are looking at doing that. The ramp is getting rather beat up, and it's just weather itself will do that to it. So we're hoping we can put one in, hopefully in the spring perhaps. All right, our children's church is making their way over, and we're glad that we have a few that are able to be in that, and thankful for that. We're going to sing a hymn now, We Are God's People, page 338 in your songbook. We'll have the words also on the screen. Ruth Allen.
Please stand.
We are God's people, the church and our Lord.
Well, I'm glad you're here. You look healthy today. You look good, even if I only see half your face, okay? Anyway, glad you're here, and we're praying that together we've come to honor Jesus Christ, to love Him, and to magnify His name. We're going to have Brenda Hartley come and sing a special for us. Good song. How does the book of Malachi today, chapter 3. I want to talk to you a little while about preparing this world for Jesus. Getting in a place where we recognize and we understand that Jesus is coming again. He came once to die on the cross for us. He comes again to receive us unto himself. And Malachi chapter 3 is a chapter of reminding that a messenger would lead the way up to Jesus' return. Behold, I will send my messenger. Verse 1 begins in chapter 3 of the book of Malachi. By the way, that's not pronounced Malachi, if you didn't know. Just wanted to make sure you're aware of that. It's Malachi. I think it's a wonderful thing to know today that we have the love of God in our lives, and he gives us the very living Word of God. By the way, I do not believe the Bible is just a translation. This is the very Word of God. 2 Timothy 3:16 says that it is the inspired or God-breathed Word with which we live. And when God the Spirit spoke to Malachi to pen these words, the full meaning, I'm quite sure, wasn't understood. And in some places in the Word of God, the Lord uses the very same illustration to tell us two matters or two things that are going to happen or unfold. And I think if we look in this passage of Scripture here in the book of Malachi, we will see that this teaching that's found in chapter 3 is really given to us that we might see some things that have happened, but also that will happen and will transpire. I want to begin this morning by talking to you about John the Baptist. He is the forerunner of Jesus Christ. He was the one who was to come as a messenger to prepare the way of the Lord. Now, this man that came, we don't know a lot about John. We know he was a little rough around the edges. We know that he ate locust and honey. I've never had a big appetite for locusts. I like honey pretty good. But anyway, he was kind of rough hewn, but he stood in the wilderness and was just faithful about proclaiming that the Messiah was coming. And his message is very clear. The intent of his word comes out of the book of Malachi, the prophecy that is here, that Jesus was coming, the Messiah is coming. So his job, his responsibility was preparing the way of the Lord. And what we find here in this passage of Scripture is after John the Baptist comes, sure enough, Jesus, the Messiah, shows up on the scene. And remember, John had the privilege of baptizing Jesus in the Jordan River. And I see some things about Jesus that I want to share with you very briefly today about who he is and why he came. He is the Messiah, the promised one, the one that they had been looking for down through the ages. And there's some interesting things about who our Lord is that I want you to see. I find that after this meeting with John, one of the very first things he does is go to the temple. In fact, his life was filled with his relationship to God. We noticed when he was just a baby born into the world, and there was a prophecy concerning Jesus Christ, his birth that was so unexpected was something surprising to those in the fact that he came. But let me tell you something today. When he comes again, his second coming will be even more surprising. I notice he came to the temple. And there is that good thought about us gathering together as God's people, of listening to messages, to heeding what God has to say. There was a pastor some years ago who was deeply concerned for the salvation of a Christ-rejecting lawyer. We still have a few of those today, don't we? And he prepared a sermon especially for him, knew him, and said, I want you to come to church. I want you to listen to the message. And he thought, boy, this is a barn-burning message. He's going to get saved for sure. Well, he came, he listened to the message, but he wasn't moved by the pastor's words. But as he was leaving the church, a lady who was not very educated approached this man, a woman whose heart was full of love and compassion of Jesus. And she approached this very learned lawyer, and with tears streaming down her face, she said, I sure love my Jesus. And won't you love my Jesus too? Well, it seems those words went as a dart into his heart, and this dead and earnest plea went there and moved in his heart, and he was moved to trust in Jesus Christ as Savior and knew of his love and forgiveness. I don't think we can overestimate the place and power that we have of personally pleading with people about their condition of knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Jesus, at a young age, went to the temple. 12 years old, the Word of God says. And in that place that had just recently been rebuilt by Herod, overall a wicked man, but trying to please the Jewish people, just 70 years after the birth of Christ, that temple is torn to the ground. But it proves beyond a shadow of a doubt in that time frame that Jesus, the Messiah, had come. At 40 days old, Luke 2:27 says he was presented at the temple there to acknowledge he was Jesus, and acknowledge that he was there for God. At 12 years old, he comes back to the temple, and he's there saying, "Wished ye not that I be about my Father's business?" Luke 2, chapter 49. And as he comes just before his time of dying on the cross, he rides in triumph on what we now call Palm Sunday into Jerusalem. And he goes directly to the temple, Matthew chapter 21. And we're reminded that so many things Jesus did centered around the temple itself. But I want you to see what he is going to do when he comes again. Jesus is coming back for us, my friends. He's coming back to take us home to be with him in heaven, but he's also coming one day to judge this world that has rejected him as Savior. Down in verse number 3, it says of our Lord, let me read verse 2 again. "But who will abide the day of his coming? And who shall stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap." It means he's come to clean up things in this world. In verse 3, "And he shall sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness." We see something of who Jesus is and what his role is, not only as our Savior, but also as our Lord and as our Judge. It talks in this passage of Scripture that he will come as a refiner. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse 26, it says that he might sanctify and cleanse us with the washing of water by the Word. That's what we're getting today, the feeding of God's Word, that cleansing power that just keeps us close to him and keeps us in a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to be that refiner. That's what he's doing through his word right now. It says he will purify the sons of Levi. Very interesting phrase to you and I who are Christians today, because Peter reminds us in 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 5, "You also, as lively stones, are built up into a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, the sons of Levi, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ." You see, when we are saved, when we are born again, we have a priesthood in our lives. We become part of God's family, and in that very sense, we are part of his agents in this world to tell others of who Jesus Christ is. He will purify the sons of Levi. Every person who is a Christian becomes a son of Levi. You're born into the family. In 1 Peter 2, 5, it says that we have that priestly office, and it reminds us that we will be purified as gold and silver. If you went to Fort Knox today, I don't know if I'd advise you to do that, but if you went there, they got a lot of gold in their bank vaults. And that gold has been purified. It went through a heat process to take out the dross, the impurities, the iron, or the other metals that might be there. And God does that to you and me. As we go through this life, sometimes he's burning out those things that are imperfect and unclean and unholy and unhealthy. God wants us to be like him. He's washing away the spots on the outside. And did I say washing? Yes, I did. W-A-R-S-H-I-N-G. That's how you spell it. You say that word. That's a Southern thing. I'm sorry. Anyway, but that's if you get one of those, that's better than just a washing, you know. So he washes us. He cleanses us. And we can be thankful for that holy wash that God gives us that cleanses our life. He's purifying our lives. In fact, it goes on to say he will purge us. And that's driving out the dross and impurities of our life. Sometimes in our hearts there are those trials that come our way and we wonder, why must I go through this? Why must I face this? Well, I often believe it's in those times that God is very strongly pulling you to be a little closer to Him. And He does that often through trial and temptation. Someone wrote, the best way to prepare for the coming of Christ is to never forget the presence of Christ. I think that's good. And He comes to make our lives better, more like His, so that as we get ready to go to heaven, it's not going to be an ultimate drastic change in the sense that you've been getting prepared to go to heaven. But I also see the Lord here in another manner as He comes. In the second coming of Christ, after He has received His bride to Him, He comes to judge the world. Verse 5 reminds us, and I will come near to you to judgment, and I will be a swift witness. And then there is listed a whole list of those who God will not accept into heaven. Now, let me clarify, if you know Jesus Christ as Savior, your life has been washed in the blood of the Lamb, and those sins are forgiven. But if you stand continuing in those sins, sorcerers, adulterers, false swears, those that oppress the hireling, or those that oppress other people, if you please, those that oppress the widow and the fatherless, the stranger in the country, the bottom line is, those that fear me not, saith the Lord of hosts. As you look at all those sinners mentioned there, God says they will be driven away. They will be judged. They will know the consequences of sin. In those five verses, there's a reminder that God does require a judgment of sin. Sometimes, I guess, we forget that. We forget that God wants to deal hastily and will deal hastily with it and wipe it away. But it is not just a forgiving of those if they reject Jesus Christ as Savior. But when I come down to verse number 7, or 6 rather, I'm pleased to read this again. Our Lord doesn't change. When He makes a promise, when He makes a vow, He'll never break it. And that's why we are not consumed. Listen to what it says in verse 6. For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed. God looks upon us. We are His children. We have been changed. We've been washed in the blood. And though we are not perfect yet, though we still have sin that stains our lives, though we still do things unconscionable and unacceptable in God's eyes, the blood covers us. And He says in verse 6, you are not consumed. Yes, sons of Jacob are not consumed. It reminds us, because of who He is to us, we have a forever relationship with Him. Now, that brings me down to the second point I want to share with you today. We are the forerunners. We are a lot like John the Baptist. There's something in each of us today that makes us unique and puts us in a position to do something special for the cause of Christ. Every Christian is kind of like John the Baptist. And maybe I should qualify that a little bit. Maybe I should say it this way. We are supposed to be like John the Baptist. And I don't think I'm stretching this too far at all here, because I see Christ in his first coming, I see Christ coming again, and we are in between those two periods. And I want you to listen to what Malachi's name means. His name means messenger of Jehovah, or my messenger. Isn't that what he calls us? We were first called Christians, the Bible says in the book of Acts, at Antioch. It reminds us that we are his. We belong to him. And we've been marked as his. And so even with that marking, I think we have to understand, if we are born again, if we know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, then you are a forerunner of Jesus Christ coming again. You're here in this middle land where we have that opportunity to witness to people and tell others of Jesus Christ. You are a messenger of good tidings. You are a declarer of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 40 and verse 3, Scripture says, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God." You see, that's what we're here to do. We're to let people know that Jesus is coming again. We're here to remind people that Jesus will come, and he will judge those who reject him as Lord and Savior. We are here to let people know there is still that opportunity to know him as Christ and Savior. It was said during the Civil War, a soldier who had enlisted in the war, he took along with him what he had done in his profession before he was a soldier. He was a watchmaker. So he had all his tools. Well, as they are camped about in one of the camps, people heard, "Old Joe down the way here, he's a watchmaker. He repairs watches." And they'd take their watches to him, and he would work on them and repair them. And that became his sideline, if you please. Well, one day the call came up, and it said, "Today we go to war, gentlemen. Today we go to battle." And this watchmaker went back to his tent. They had said, break camp, fold your tents up, and get ready to go to battle. And this man looked around and he said, "I still have 12 watches to repair. I promised I'd get them done by Saturday night." Well, the man had forgot what he had enlisted for. You see, the soldiers of the King of Kings sometimes forget what they're enlisted for. We're here to let people know that Jesus loves them, that he came to save them from their sins. We're here to tell them that Jesus is coming again. We are the messengers. We are the opportunity. We stand between him and the second coming when he will judge the world. What do we do with that? How do we respectably tell people and responsibly tell people they need Jesus as Lord and Savior? I hope we understand that declaring the gospel is our duty. It should be our passion. You're his messengers. You're here with a responsibility that doesn't go away. And honestly, one day we will answer for when we stand before him. Preparing the world for Jesus. Not just a motto. It's not just filling up a church building. It's not just listening on our Facebook broadcast or YouTube broadcast. It's that attitude we have when we meet someone to remind them they need Jesus as Lord and Savior. I hope we get that in our hearts today, that we can be the John the Baptist that make a difference. You may not eat locusts, but I guarantee you're in this time, and this is your duty to honor him and to serve him before he comes again. We're going to sing a hymn called Blessed Assurance. Today, before you stand, before you move from your pew, I want you to know and understand that God calls us to be his servants, his faithful servants. Maybe there are some here today who know Jesus as Lord and Savior but need to go that additional step. Maybe you'd like to become a part of Fair Park Community Baptist Church. I'd invite you to come forward today, and we'll meet you here, and you can join in fellowship with us here in this church this day. Maybe there are some who just need to pray. And I know you can pray in your pew where you're at, and I encourage you to pray there. But let's be active about what God calls us to do, to live for Him until He comes back to get us to be with Him. Let's stand as we sing our hymn, Blessed Assurance. Ruth Allen? Thank you so much for listening today, for we pray God working in our lives that we go out and do His will and His bidding. Thank you for those who have listened online. We're glad you joined in with us and pray we've been a blessing and help in your life. We're going to close in a word of prayer. I'm going to ask Ron Sheff if you would dismiss us in a word of prayer. You can take your mask off to dismiss us, okay? Amen.